This week on The Breakdown, this happened.
The Wallabies have a famous victory. In fact, it's a hiding.
We chat all things Perth. We hear from a couple of stars of the game. And we have our eyes on the north as the RWC ramp up continues. All this and more here on The Breakdown.
Hello and welcome to The Breakdown. Well, a lot has happened in the last 7 days. The All Blacks, they lost their number one ranking for about 24 hours. Then they got it back. The Black Ferns, well, they locked down the Laurie O'Riley Trophy for 2019. Of course, Mota 10 Cup kicked off on the weekend in some fantastic action. Where do we start? Let's start with the panel. There is Ellie Williams is here, Sir John Kirwan and Mills Muliaina. 7 days ago, Ellie, we're sitting here in this very studio thinking to ourselves, let's go and watch the All Blacks go to Perth and dominate. How surprised are you sitting here right now after what happened on the weekend?
Oh, hugely surprised. I mean, first person to get it wrong, won't be the last person to get it wrong. I mean, you know, I was confident that we would smash them, and we got smashed. So a lot can happen in a week when it comes to rugby.
How they respond, JK, is going to be fascinating. But you're sitting here in New Zealand watching this, you're thinking, this is great, 60,000 people at Optus Stadium, the scene is set. Half of them were Kiwis, and then the All Blacks didn't deliver. Surprised?
Well, hang on a minute. Hang on a minute. I can't wait for this week.
Can't wait.
You know, like, yes, go, boys. It was, we started slow, we made mistakes, but we came back into the game, Mills, with 5 minutes to go in the first half, it's 13-12, and then a red card changes the game. Did Australia deserve to win? Yes. Did we get dominated? Did we fall off too many tackles? Yes. I think it's a little thing called when you rely too much on your process and you forget to bring the mongrel, the passion, awesome, and that, Mills. And that can be fixed up. But the red card was incredibly big moment.
It was a big moment, Mills. But it's not to take away anything from what was a great contest. It could have been a better contest, but in the end, isn't this what this game is all about? We respect their opposition, we respect what they're capable of, and now we probably get the contest we really want, right?
Oh.
The Bledisloe Cup is on the line this weekend. It wasn't on the line in Perth.
Yeah, and you've got to remember, you know, Steve Hansen's always said, this is the most important thing. Never mind the championship, you know, we want to make sure we keep the Bledisloe. And I agree with what JK said. I think, you know, often, that was probably the one disappointing part from the All Blacks' performance, is they didn't bring that hard stuff, that edge to their game, and that was where the Australians won the game. They won the Test match through that, through pure passion and pride and being able to win the contact.
We're going to look into this game in depth. We have to.
Yeah, just one point that really, and Mills and I spoke about it, you know, dumb penalty from Artie, pushing, you know, Hooper in the back. Artie smashes people. He doesn't push people in the back. Mm. And when I saw that, I thought we're a bit off our game, Ellie, you know what I mean?
I just think the Aussies got inside us a little bit. And look, I can see what's happening. They're trying to get a bit of physicality, a bit of mongrel, when the game wasn't there for them to impose that. But, you know, Artie doing that, he's trying to spark something.
Do you know what I love here?
Give it a bit of something.
We've got a whole show to discuss about this, and you guys are trying to do it in the very first part. We've got plenty of time. We're emotional about it. We don't like losing, mate. You've been hanging on to this for the last 24, 48 hours. You want to get it out, let it go. You get it out tonight. You'll get your chance. We shouldn't forget, though, 60,000 people, like I said, at Optus Stadium. The fans were there. Of course, we had two fantastic teams on show. Four, in fact. We shouldn't forget the Wallaroos and Black Ferns. It was a fantastic occasion. We need to look at it in detail, but also celebrate what was a great contest.
The Wallabies are ready, the All Blacks are primed. Strap yourself in, this is going to be a big one.
Uncharacteristic missed tackles wasn't there from the All Blacks.
We missed a lot of first time tackles in that first 20, 30 minutes.
Yeah, our defence just wasn't up to scratch tonight.
They came out with great plan, great intensity. In.
Full credit to Aussie, mate, they came out of the blocks quite good.
Here's O'Connor. Oh, pass! Beautifully away to Hodge, they won't stop him. Reece Hodge has got a free run home. Try.
Possession was a big, big problem, and I think it came down to early discipline.
I think our discipline doesn't help when we give silly penalties away.
Our discipline wasn't good.
It could be a red card against four.
Wow.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that is correct. Contact to the neck.
We lost Scotty through poor discipline, and, you know, they're the wrong side to try and play 14 men against.
So they got a red card, and it changed things up a bit.
Changed the context in the modern game.
Stays blindside.
Michael Hooper can sense something he hasn't sensed very often.
Man down, and they were still playing and still really hurt us.
Barrett! Booted Barrett scores!
Oh, what a game!
Good, when we held onto the ball, we've got opportunities.
We had to keep on with our stuff, focus on us, and we did that tonight.
He's got some support.
Oh!
Oh, they can't put him away, and Nick White has scored a brilliant try. And the Wallabies have a famous victory.
You know, certainly listens for us, most definitely.
We're stoked, seeing the smiles on our staff, players' faces, and the crowd as well is amazing.
The camaraderie inside the team over the last couple of months has made it a pleasure to be in.
It's a pretty raw feeling being an All-Black team and getting smoked like that by Aussie.
The hurt will sit in the belly and it will burn and it will fire us up for next week.
It's only half the job and it's going to be a huge test next week.
Well, we know that the All Blacks are going to go up another level over there at Eden Park.
We lost Scotty through poor discipline, and as a result of that, everyone else had to work harder, and Australia gained us for it.
Yes, a massive result for Australia over the weekend, which makes for an even better game this weekend. But one thing that slightly overshadowed their win was the Scott Barrett red card. Now, the decision from the hearing came through today and he ended up with a 3-week ban, which isn't as bad as it could have been. It could have been a 6-week ban potentially, and that's because he put in an early guilty plea, showed plenty of remorse and did have a squeaky clean record. Now, Eddie Jones had this to say about the red card at his most recent press conference.
Oh, I thought it was ridiculous, mate. You know, a bloke gets tackled, he goes to be second man in and his shoulder hits his head and he gets a red card. But we can't have that in the game. You know, there's got to be some common sense applied. Maybe common sense was applied today really well. But what I'm saying is that then we need to have some consistency and common sense. I think it's important for the game, really important for the game. And I urge World Rugby... although I don't think they do anything at great pace, do they? To get some consistency in that area, because otherwise we're going to have games that are being destroyed by an inconsistent official making a decision on a rule that's on a law that's not clear.
Now, guys, the World Cup is 5 weeks away. Is this going to be the new normal? Is this the precedent that they're setting for this behaviour?
And I think that, Steph, is what Eddie Jones is talking about. And he said it so succinctly, like Eddie can do. The fact he's thrown it out there, he's put it in front of him, JK. You know, Eddie, you were not long ago in Italy. We talked about this last week. Had a chat with him, had a coffee with him. But you sense what he's saying. But he's probably got concerns, hasn't he, about the fact that if this happens in a World Cup, it could be tournament over for a player. Yeah, but you know what? And well said, Eddie.
Yeah, well said.
Son.
We don't often say that on the show. On the show, it doesn't happen very
well. Well said. And Kafer, you owe New Zealand an apology. Saying that it was targeted, because that's just... We don't need ex-players saying that because it's wrong. These players today, they're going hard, but there's very rarely someone who does it on purpose. So you ask a beer. But the interesting thing for me is that if you take a look at this game... Now, let's... Aussie deserved to win. Let's take that off the table. Why are international coaches talking about this? Because in any game... In that game on Saturday night, there was about 10 neck rolls. I won't say... From who? Because a lot of times both teams are guilty. But if Barrett gets a red card, there's neck rolling, going in from the side. That is red card, right? So watch this, boom. That is red card, attacking the head. Now, I'm not targeting Australia. The reason Eddie Jones said that is because it happens, right? It happens. And it's not intentional, it's just the way it goes. Although some coaches might coach head rolling, but I hope not. However, they're coming out, even actually Checker after game, Ali said, look, it's wrong, because there wasn't intent. And I don't think he should have got 3 weeks either. He paid the price, the team paid the price, New Zealand paid the price, and it wasn't intentional. Common sense.
Yeah, and I think that's what he's asking for. I think, you know, when you've got coaches coming out like that and actually saying, well, a little bit of common sense, they haven't got clarity on it. And this is when they need clarity. They need World Rugby to come out and say, well, this is how we're going to police it and show a little bit of common sense.
And I think what they're trying to say is, how do you stop a human being running, now that they're this big, this strong, the teams are so organised. How do we stop them if we can't use arms, shoulders like this? Like, what was Scott Barrett meant to do there to try and help him? Well, is he meant to step back and say, OK, you take the momentum, you go forward? The problem you've got is you've got a physical game. You need to physically stop people on that game line. Otherwise, you're stuffed. And there's no technical way to tackle.
I'd say this, though, the fact that you can't get yourself in a position where you end up contacting with the head. That's a no-go area. Yes, I get it. There are accidentals. Yes, I get that. There are incidental contacts. But I think it's the fact that a red card was handed out here. That's... I would have had no issue with the yellow card.
Exactly.
The fact it was reckless, but there was no purpose, there was no intent. He takes his 10 minutes, maybe do you make it longer? I don't know, but the reality for me, and I take your point, you're defending your try line. It's a physical game. It's got the point you've got to stop their momentum. Yeah. But in the end, you also have to protect the ball carrier.
I don't know if I agree with you, Goldie, because I think it's a red card. Yeah. That's not the problem.
Well, you can't stop the ball.
But there's another five in the same game.
Yes.
And there's another five in England versus Wales. That's what Eddie Jones is saying. But if we actually do this, we're gonna end up with 5-on-5.
Yeah.
But the counter
we can
is,
come back.
The counter is, how does our game fix this? Because that's the bigger problem. How do we actually fix this in terms of not having those rules in place, accepting that there is going to be head contact? If there's malice in it, then I agree, we've got to go somewhere. But you, as a forward, you're stuck in... You guys wouldn't know this, I'm going to let you know, but when you're stuck in the cul-de-sac and it's going heated, you throw everything at it to try and stop that momentum. And that's what you've got
to
do.
Look, I think we need to come back to looking at rugby league sometimes. Put it on report. Yellow card on report. Yeah. I reckon that with no intention with Barrett, he shouldn't have got any extra weeks. But if he goes yellow card and it goes up there, then...
Yeah, but that's my point.
Give him his weeks.
Yeah, I mean, when there is an intentional act, Mills, where someone has taken and deliberately shown foul play and possibly injured a player because of it, I have no issue with a red card there. But you think about the contest, you think about what's at stake, you think about the people who invested the game, the fans. Reality is, it has to be on the extreme level.
Yeah.
And there was no intent there. None whatsoever.
So maybe do we need a rule where he goes off for 10 minutes and then they review it? Well, the guy upstairs reviews it and says, well, he doesn't get to go back on because that's a red card offence, but we can bring someone else off the bench. And then that way it's 15-on-15. I don't know.
That's not going to happen in a hurry. But, that's our danger zone right now. The other concern I have, is the fact we haven't heard from World Rugby saying the decision was either right or wrong.
Well, we don't.
So we don't want to... Yeah, but that's a problem in itself, right?
We've got to wait for the pigeon to fly down with the memo saying, oh, look, this is what we've decided on. It's taken 4 weeks.
Doesn't arrive that
way. But let me...
Exactly, that's what we're saying. They don't have emails at World Rugby. They've only got the old pigeon. That's why their decisions are so slow. And Eddie is bang on, mate. The first time I've ever agreed with Eddie. What a legend.
The other thing that I want to talk about is, if that was unintentional, is a neck roll intentional?
Yes, of course it is. How else do you get them out of there?
Well, I would look at that in a different light, absolutely.
But it's more intentional than what Barrett did, right?
But the other thing is, they've policed the neck roll constantly. That was the biggest thing they came out with. No neck rolls, because there's always going to be a penalty. There wasn't one. And that's probably what the players are coming out now and a little bit frustrated by, because you get a penalty from that, it changes the whole momentum of the game.
Yeah. We're going
to... Look, we are not taking anything away from a great Australian performance, because Australia will be in this situation like England would, and that's why Eddie Jones has come out. So we need to do something.
OK, let's talk about then how good this Wallaby team was. You talk about the fact what we don't want to do is take anything away from their performance, because you would have to say, on the scoreboard at halftime, they were only up by 4 points. But to me, Ali, they were in complete control of that game.
Oh, totally agree. Complete control. Set piece, they dominated. Lineouts, they were very structured. They were working the back of the lineout in terms of how they were trying to attack and manipulate our defence. You look at Christian Lelefano, how he was running it, what runners he was going to. And then I put it down to Nick White was looking exactly like a classic Georgie Gregan. He was holding, he was questioning our defenders. Are we going, is our first step forward? Is our first step sideways? Because he's running with the ball. I generally say I haven't seen an Australian team dominate like this, both physically and tactically, for a long, long time.
I thought we banned his name on the show. I've not told you about that.
Who's that?
Georgie's. I thought we'd bring up Georgie's. But you talk about attack.
We'll get rid of him, mate.
But Mills, at half-time, though, was it their attack or just our inaccuracy on defence and purely missed tackles?
I think that's the worrying part. Some of those missed tackles, you know, they were easy missed tackles. They should have been made. And so you question, you know, where their mindset was, some of the All Blacks. But when you go into half-time, you know, with 14 men, all of a sudden the mindset changes. You know, you can't go to set piece. But the problem was, We'd already lost the set-piece stuff. We'd lost the contact in the first half. So then, all of a sudden, it becomes helter-skelter. But I think the disappointing part from the All Blacks' point of view is they just weren't on edge. They came out in that first 10 or so minutes. Aussies dominated physically. They were smarter. They were getting, and you talk about White, but he was getting quick ball compared to the way we were functioning.
But the Aussies,
I've had enough of being that nice to them.
The Aussies rode their luck. So if we look at a lot of these plays before, there was a bounce pass. They got on the outside. James O'Connor's pass. He hasn't played centre, international centre.
Yeah,
he hasn't played centre for ages.
This is the best I've seen their forward pack. The best their forward pack performed against us. Their set piece was strong. You talked about that.
Yep.
They carried strongly. I mean, I look at all of the ways that they put us under pressure in this game, Ellie, and it was in every part of the game. Now, in saying that, though, we didn't have the second 40 minutes with 15 men to do what we've done in the past.
Yeah, correct.
Which is find a way to win a game like that.
As an All Blacks supporter, I still wouldn't sit there going, whoa. We're well out of our depth. Look, we were a man down for half that match. The first half, yes, we came back in the tail end, but I think there is room for us to say there's enough on what we're doing that we don't lose it.
He's taking his deep breaths.
Yeah, I'm just taking some meditation breaths.
Medication or meditation?
Meditation. Meditation. But I think let's not get too carried away because I think that the All Blacks need to say... We got too caught up in process, we relied on the process, we didn't bring Mungrel in the edge. The lack of a guy in the second half made us drift too much on defence. It's down to this week, forget it, down to this week.
Well, there's been plenty of reaction, and we've seen that already on tonight's show. There's plenty of reaction from inside the All Blacks. We heard from a number of players over the weekend, and today Ian Foster had his verdict on the performance.
Well, we're excited about the next one, you know, like it's... Yeah, your emotional part comes pretty soon after the final whistle, and you sulk for a little while, and then you go through a process of trying to figure things out, and then you roll your sleeves back and get back into work, and that's really what we've done right across the board. We got beat to the punch a bit by the Aussies. They were certainly up for the game, so I think mentally we need to make sure that we're ready.
We could have been. We maybe taken a little bit for granted, to be fair. Like if we're being honest, and. You know, we spoke about that, so yeah, I think as an All Black, that's pretty tough to take. And, yeah, a bit of soul searching, and we've got 7 days to put everything we can into to make sure we get to that place we need to on Saturday.
You know, the Aussies were just good enough to hold on to the ball in that last quarter and take their opportunities through just, you know, good attack. We clearly had to do a little bit more than what we did, so I think we expect a little bit more out of everyone.
Mills, how would you expect them to respond, given what you've heard there, and we've mentioned so much already, how would you expect this All Black group? We've all been in situations exactly like this. They've been in this before in World Cup years. How do you expect the response to be for this game at Eden Park?
Oh, look, I think, you know, Dan Cole's sort of mentioned it. You know, they lost the contact. They're pretty disappointed at the way they went out there and mentally sort of went to the game. So I think this week will be fairly quiet. They'll knuckle down. And you're right, Ali. The fact that there's not too much there to be able to say, wow, man, let's panic. Because they win that physical battle, they win they get a bit more pill, I think we're okay. So I'm not panicking at all. I just think they just got to win that Mungrel.
I can't wait. Honestly, I cannot wait. It's going to be a great test match. Haven't looked forward to a test match for this long. I'm not worried about the players. What I'm concerned about is selection. Because I think the selectors are going to be under pressure because their plan might have been thrown out by losing. You know, do you play Sevu Reese? If you won last weekend, you can take some risks and try. It's sunny start. So there's a whole lot of things going on in the selection. Do you have the courage to carry on with your two pivots?
Well, following on from that, you're talking about game plan, you're talking about execution then, you're talking about the combinations you put together, Ellie. Do they persevere with the way they are playing? And are some of the things and mistakes they are making and errors they are making, are they easy fixes? Are they things that individuals can take care of? We talked about the missed tackles. Are errors in similar vein?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, firstly, you've got to look and listen. Every time Dane Cole speaks, he's telling the truth. He wears his heart on the sleeve and he tells it exactly. He felt embarrassed. You could see it in the, you know, about around how he did it. What we've got to focus on is we keep doing what we're trying to do, I think. You can't change things now, you know. They talk about game plans, blah, blah, blah. You've got to keep to what we're doing because it can work when we execute it well. We've just got to relieve the pressure mentally on these players to just start playing naturally. At the moment, I think in the first three test matches of the year, we've seen players playing hindered because of what they think they should be doing, rather than let's drop it now, let's just go out and win, play how what we see and win. That's as simple as it gets, I reckon.
They're easy words to say, though. Yeah. When I come back to what you've talked about, OK, bring back some physicality, bring back that intensity, but the balance has to be right, that you don't give away penalties as a result of that, because that's that point, you get to that point or that level where you're well and truly over the top. You're pushing the boundaries too far.
Yeah, and that's one of the things that's hindered them, you know, right at the very beginning, giving away huge penalties, and they're just not getting into the game. So all of a sudden, you know, things like this, you spoke about that. I mean, when you see that, I don't think it was a penalty. I think it was stupid that it became a penalty. But as an All Black, why do we need to go to that? We actually dominate in terms of smashing someone and going backwards. But the penalty count, particularly early on, you know, they're sitting on their heels now because, you know, they're going back and they're being dictated about how they play. And Australia were very good on
I think we have to give Australia some credit around how they mentally manipulated us, because Artie Sevilla, I haven't seen do that all year. He was frustrated. They frustrated us, and that was the issue. Look, we're going to be a bit of
I don't agree. I reckon we're frustrating ourselves. I think there's too many errors and too many discipline mistakes in the first 20 minutes, and we're not getting a great start.
No
flow. I mean, you know, we were talking a few years ago, we get up by 30 points in the first 30 minutes. So I don't disagree, actually, talking up
the Aussies. Because you know what it's like, they get a big hot
air balloon
and then
we
get them, pop them, and they're going to the Garden of Eden.
And they're coming to town, right?
The sensible thing that Ali did say, though, is that, you don't coach attitude. The players can bring that. But it's going to be hard to find that balance this week. You'll be chomping to get out there, and you've got to find that balance between being tough, like Millsy said, staying within the discipline, and hanging on to the football. Yeah.
It's been a difficult 12 months for the All Blacks. You look at their last six results and the way things have gone. And obviously the win in Perth on the weekend and the draw, the late draw though, South Africa getting up, a win in Argentina, dominant against Italy, and then those two results on the end of your tour, Ireland and England squeaking a one-point win over that. We shouldn't forget as well against South Africa last year. Those two results back-to-back where we got out of jail in Pretoria to draw that series with them. So look, there's no doubt at the moment, we've talked about it a lot, it's closed up. It's well and truly closed up. You talked about the penalty count, you talk about the discipline, and here are, in those last six games, the number of penalties they've conceded in the first half. South Africa and Australia, look at the against Ireland, 9 penalties. On average, 5 penalties in the first half. Now, what does that mean? Quite often, it means there's a couple of statistics in the game you can't control. And those are possession and those are territory. It's giving the ball away, and what it's in is means you're playing in the right part, wrong parts of the field, because the opposition can get down there. And JK, you talked about it in the end. There's a number of things that contribute to not winning games of rugby, and discipline and how you control the ball are a big part of it.
Yeah, and I think when you put those two stats together, it's important to realise, and we're not picking on Artie because we know how good he is, but that penalty, it was our ball, you get kicked down into your half. So there are, like, 5 penalties, 3 of those might have been dumb at the wrong time. You know, sometimes you can give away 5 penalties, often in your own 22, your head's over the ball and it's irrelevant. But when it translates into constant pressure, sitting in your own half, not getting in your own half, also some of our kicks, and I can understand why they're trying to do it, but chip kicks out of your own half, right, taking a risk, 50-50 ball, those things just keep the pressure on you all the time.
Here's a question, Millsy. Have we lost the favourites tag going into the World Cup after the last 2 or 3 results, or after those results that you showed us on that board?
Have we lost it? Of course we have. But do we need it? I don't think we should be too worried about going in as favourites or not, because that's
music to our ears, you know that.
I totally agree.
It should be music to everybody's ears.
I actually like the position that we're in, because it's going to be a tight Rugby World Cup. But I like the fact that, okay, if we peel everything back over the last 3 weeks, we haven't shown much. We honestly haven't. You know, okay, we've definitely underperformed. But I think, you know, this week we'll bring a lot of heart. There's been a lot of heart. There's obviously been a lot of soul searching. And once you click that together with a really good game plan, we've got the skill to be able to come out of this and keep the better zone and go into the Rugby World Cup nice and confident that we can get past those first 4 games.
I don't actually care about this week. I think it's fantastic, and I hope we win. But actually, it's about the World Cup. And I'll come back to it because I reckon it's fascinating. The most fascinating thing for me this week is selection. Because by losing, that throws you out. So do you... That is... Who are they going to play at lock, Ali?
I'll go Hemapo and Whitelock.
So okay. That's the first
Who are they going to play at 12, Millsy?
Oh, I have to say Lamape would go in there now.
So who's going to play? Hold on then, JK. So who's going to be at 10 and 15? Because that combination is what they've decided over the last couple of test matches is going to be the combination. Well, is it the combination going forward? You look at what's result. They talked about this in 2018, the dual pivot role, when it was Beauden Barrett and it was Damien McKenzie. This year, it's Richie Mwanga and Beauden Barrett. And you talk about the balance then and what they're doing. There it is. Equal carries, 11 and 12. Metres gained. Passes in the game. Kicks in the game. More coming from Beauden Barrett. Does that mean he's playing a bit more of a traditional game, Mills?
Yeah, and that's probably why. I mean, he's a different 15. I mean, I love this. I think once they get it together, it's just going to be absolutely magical. But the thing that you get is that Mwanga perhaps feels that, you know, you've got the best, one of the best players in the world, if not best player in the world, at fullback, and he's actually shifted forward. So he's not actually taking control of the game. And that's where Beauden perhaps needs to let go a little bit more to give, you know, Mwanga the opportunity to say, well, I'm going to take, you know, this game by the scruff of the neck and I'll lead.
I thought early, Millsy, and I'd like your opinion. Normally when you go out the back door to the fullback, he's kicking it long down into the channels, right? There was a couple of those short kicks. You think that was just a vision thing because it put us under pressure and it was coming from Bodie from the back, right? Little chip kicks. That one went into the knees.
And possibly on a different page. You know, Bodie's obviously seen an opportunity there and he thinks, OK, I'm good enough, I'm skillful enough to get that in there, but no one's actually seen the same thing. So once you get a little bit more time in that position, then everyone else starts to, you know, get what you're actually trying to do. And it all comes back to combinations. You know, they get a bit more feeling and all of a sudden it becomes comfortable.
And have we seen that combination work with momentum, with everything, all the pistons firing, everything going well? When it works for the All Blacks, it works. It worked for the Wallabies on the weekend. And yes, you've got to have a great game plan. You've got to execute, but you have to have individuals who throw things at the All Blacks that they haven't seen for a while. And for me on the weekend, Mills, it was Nick White. The selection of him ahead of Will Guinea was a surprise one, but he took every opportunity.
Oh, it was a surprise. But as you see here, this is where he was really good in the game. His ability to get to that second defender and just make him hesitate a little bit. And so this is relatively, you know, slowish kind of ball, but he gets through and all of a sudden he steps through. Guys are hesitating getting off that line. Here again as well, he's taking that nice big arc and all of a sudden it's got Coles at the back there. He has to wait a little bit because Moody hasn't quite pushed enough and covered that hole. All of a sudden, he goes through a nice gaping hole and the All Blacks are on the back foot. And this is where he was so clever. Nice little offload and bang, they're away.
And I spoke to him after the game and he could hardly recollect what's happened because reality is he's playing off the cup, he's reading opportunities. Just this little skip here, Sam Whitelock is engaged. He's watching what he's doing, which creates a hole for Tupou to then step and get over the advantage line and keep the momentum rolling for the Mills.
Yeah, because they have to wait for him. You know, he's sniped a little wee bit. All of a sudden he's a little bit smarter. He's seen that they're waiting for him. So look at the big gap here. He has a little weird look and of course, yes, the All Blacks are on the back foot, but he's manipulating now that heart defence, and this is the key area that the All Blacks sort of, you know, got lost a little bit. All of a sudden, you know, desperate. Mwanga takes a nice little tackle. That's a desperate tackle. They clear it up, but the fact was the damage was done by White.
Just the hold on the inside, just the meter they're holding on the inside creates space on the outside. So he's doing that on the back of the momentum they were getting through the middle of the park and the great go forward and clean out. And this is about ruck speed. The standard when you're talking at the highest level is quicker than 3 second ball. Just watch these plays, Mills. Talk us through it, the fact this is how quick they're delivering and getting over the advantage line and finding and distributing the ball.
But the awareness, you know, being able to Tupou there, you know, picking the ball up when it's at the back, you know, going there and carrying that on. You look at the clean out here, look at that quick ball, and all of a sudden they're away, they go wide. You know, the clean out here, obviously, you know, we talked about the Necro, but he cleared him out and left a nice wee hole there. Then who's going to stop this guy from that far out and with a bit of momentum?
And if you get three or four of those in a row, you're going to find plenty of space, you're going to find plenty of maturity. A quick ruck, just 1 second ball, then all of a sudden, all of the All Blacks are having to recover, to chase back, retreating. If you can recycle as quick as that, Guinea then on, he's read the play, he's seen what's happened in the rest of the game, he then gets it going and keeps it rolling.
But what I love about the Australians is the awareness. Yes, they sniped around the corner, all of a sudden they got quick ball. The All Blacks, they're sure that inside up, but now the opportunity is on the outside, everyone's on the same page, and then they start going to a little bit of width, nice wee hole just off the blind side, wrong side running, bang, try.
And that was their intensity right from the start of the game, their intent. The All Blacks, then in the second half, they got forced into playing some phase play. They were chasing the game, then all of a sudden, they started to get some momentum and look just as dangerous, remembering less than 3 second ball. You generate that, you'll continue to be a threat.
And this is comforting, seeing the All Blacks do this. You've got to remember, 14 men, you know, they're down to 14 men. Their ability to stay nice and patient, yes, they didn't quite win that contact there, but still, it's still relatively quick ball. You know, winning the contact through stepping, offloading and things like that, and also patience. Now, the game's changed for them. They've got to play that helter-skelter stuff, and this is where I said before, it's comforting to see the All Blacks, you know, haven't gone away from that. They obviously know the plan, and all of a sudden it sort of pays off.
And the fact that I'd like to see them do this earlier, because I feel if you control possession, you control the game. The destiny's in your own hand. The first half, we tended to kick away. If you can get multiple phases, then you can get the mismatches and get the dangerous ball carriers in the right spot. Just watch here, our two playmakers.
Yeah, exactly. And you just seen, yeah, Muliaina just got off the ground. Now, it's easy for your Bowden to get in there and go first receiver. This is why this combination is so dangerous, because Muliaina pushes back, Barrett goes to second receiver, he snipes a little hole, and that's all he needs when he gets a little bit wider. You know, he's probably used to, you know, on the inside there, defensive coming up really fast. All of a sudden, he gets a nice little gap, aware, bang, he's under the post.
And we will see very quickly, early on, I would say, in Auckland. And, of course, conditions could be different. In fact, how these two teams adjust and whether they make adjustments, Mills.
Well, they will make adjustments, I think. Another week together also from the All Blacks' point of view, I think, you know, they'll possibly look to kick a bit more. Do the Australians, this is a big question, do Australians go to kick, because it didn't kick much at all in Perth, I mean, and that came off for them in the end. So tactically, I think, you know, earlier on especially, that's going to be interesting.
Over the weekend, of course, it was the first of our double headers. Not only the All Blacks in action, the Black Ferns were in action as well, and for a second year running in the first test match of the year, they locked up the Laurie O'Riley Trophy.
From a legend of the game. The father and son duo join us in the studio, plus we have our eye on the north. Don't go anywhere.
Crowds at Eden Park, Eroni Clarke, Caleb Clarke in studio. Great to have you with us. Thanks for coming along. You've had a busy weekend, though, Eroni. I wasn't even aware of the fact you're part of the whole judiciary committee and process. And, of course, I don't want details of what's going on. How long have you been doing that for?
Well, pretty much since its inception.
Really?
Which is probably about getting into 10 years now. So it's I thought the Sands, I had really thought it was a good idea that they get a perspective from former players. So that when the chair's kind of making some judgments that, you know, you've got some former players, you're saying, well, this is the perspective that we bring into that situation. So this is what they might have been thinking. So it just really helps with the process.
You're really hoping never to see Caleb there, right?
I just about thought I might have in that North Harbour.
Oh, really? On the weekend?
So the kickoff.
It was an accident.
It was an accident.
I just wanted the ball.
Scott Barrett saying the same thing. It was an accident. Yeah. Let's talk about. I want to talk about, because this connection, obviously, father and son. Caleb, for you, you know, you were very, obviously, very, very young. And when Ronnie had finished, when did you start being aware of the fact that, you know, what he'd done in rugby?
Yeah, like
growing up, maybe primary school, I used to just tell people, like, oh, my dad was an All Black. Like, I wanted a little bit of that swag around that age. But I don't think it hit me about high school. Yep. I think I just remember playing an under-14s game and then just getting pointed at, like, oh, that's Eroni Clarke, son. And that's when it first hit. I was like, oh, wow, like, he must have done something really special for me to get noticed, but just as his son. So, yeah, it started.
How did you deal with that?
It was definitely a struggle at first. I didn't know sort of any different, and I was a bit too scared to sort of approach my dad about it and say, like, oh, Dad, like, all I feel like is just I'm your son. Like, I don't know if I'm going to be anything else. But I remember when I built the courage to actually talk to him about it, he gave me some great advice. And
all right, Eroni. Let's just see whether the advice, as he remembers it. I mean, what is it you talked about? The fact there's, look, there's so much pressure on. There's so many opportunities for young men now. They have dreams of going on and following and maybe their father's footsteps. I mean, for you, what was the conversation you had to have?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, when Caleb made that known to me that there was this kind of this pressure that was on him, I just really brought him aside and I said to him, son, I have no expectation of you to live as Dad lived. You've got to live your life. You've been blessed with a gift. I certainly can't run as quick as you at your age, but certainly, wow, that's you've got this ability to be able to go on and do it because you've been gifted to do this and you love this game. But it's, in terms of a father, whether you go on to be an All Black, I've got no expectation. And you don't have to think whether that, or Dad, that I'm trying to make this for Dad, but Dad's had a good life. I've really enjoyed my rugby.
So has he coached you through the teams? Has that happened?
Yeah, he has. I think the first time he coached me was, like, I think I was 7 years old. And through those times,
right,
I used to get a lot of telling offs.
So I've coached both of my sons, and neither of them listened to me. Did he listen to you when you're coaching? You know, this is him at Mount Elmer Grabber, this is you at Mount Elmer Grabber. As you're going through and watching it, how do you go about helping him, Eroni, to try and get better?
Yeah, I think there's a couple of things. I mean, there are different touch points in his life growing up that where, as a father, you just come in and you just be that voice. But often you've got to trust in the coaches that are around him that can feed into him, because I can tell him the same thing, and all of a sudden, and you'll hear it from a coach, and he'll think, wow, Dad, you know what my coach just taught me? And I thought, isn't that the same thing that I was...
Are my boys at home watching this? Exactly what I've said, you know. But that process, sometimes it is hard too, because you're playing for teams, right? You're playing for teams where you've got your own coaches who've got their own ways of doing things. Sometimes it can be a little bit different, so sometimes you've got to work it out for yourself, right?
Yeah, definitely. So I might have to come to Dad, but at the same time, there are things I won't tell him, so just to keep the coach happy, maybe. So yeah, I'll just keep on the same app as my coach, and I might hear it from Dad, like another perspective, but yeah, just got to listen to who you have to listen to, I guess. So.
Along the way, though, you've had some difficult challenges you've had to make and decisions you've had to make. You played part of the New Zealand under-20s, but then the New Zealand Sevens program came knocking because of your, obviously, speed and your talent. That balance between Sevens and 15s, I mean, how did you come to the decision to look in the 15-man game?
So I've always had dreams and sort of aspirations to play the 15s game and go as far as I possibly could. Sevens was something very different that I didn't see coming at all, especially last year. So I thought, you know what, this is an opportunity. I wasn't really looked at around playing as much just because of my age and just because of all the other players around, like Rico and boys like that. So they definitely let me go and play Sevens last year, and that was sort of an experience that I loved, and it was awesome.
Did you find it really valuable, that experience?
Yeah, definitely. I got to just express myself. I lost a lot of kgs playing Sevens because there was just a lot of running, and yeah, I got to go. I just went in Sydney and Hamilton, but I got to meet a lot of players that I watched growing up, you know, just watching the Sevens circuit. So yeah, it was awesome and something I'd value a lot.
Eroni, did you ever play Sevens?
Yeah, I did. In fact, probably 93 was probably my best year
with Auckland.
With Auckland and with New Zealand Sevens. Yep. We're kind of the B team. I think that's when Titch was just starting out for New Zealand too. So,
how long did you last with Titch?
Oh, a couple of years.
Yeah, well done.
So with the good old with Titch's approach.
But in those days, it was a real pathway, wasn't it?
Yes.
It was a real opportunity for players to develop a different set of skills and also see the world in a different way.
But I think also too, it was kind of the way that we kind of prepared for the 15 season, because then, you know, Sevens was starting, January, February, so it helped us to prepare for the 15s, that started in March and April, so, yeah.
A lot of fun, a lot of things I want to continue to keep talking about, but over the weekend we saw the beginning of the Mitre 10 Cup. There were some great results, some great performances for a number of teams.
The Mitre 10 Cup of 2019 kicked off at Invercargill last Thursday with the Stags hosting the Taniwha. Northland were too strong for Southland, although the Stags scored arguably the try of the match. Auckland got off to a flyer in the Battle of the Bridge with the opening two tries.
It's been snapped up by Caleb Clarke. Duffy tried to make the tackle, couldn't hold him. Well, here's an opportunity for Auckland, and they're in. Oh, and now Rayasi drops the ball. Duffy clears it away. Oh, this could be remarkable.
Harbour showed resilience to claw back into the game and could have won it in the dying minutes with a penalty attempt. However, it missed, and a draw was the end result. Liam Squire made an impressive return to Tasman colours at Blenheim with a dominant display. The Marcos starting their season strongly with a 40-point thumping of Wellington. And at Pukekohe on Saturday afternoon, Taranaki scored 5-4 over Counties Manukau in an entertaining encounter. Crowd favourite Wasaki Naholo scoring another trademark try for the visitors.
Josepha Scott's got it for Waikato. Fletcher Smith again. Oh, lovely hands. Sweeney, chance here.
The match of the round was in Hamilton, where newly promoted Waikato played host to perennial favourites Canterbury. The lead changed hands several times before a 68-minute try to Waikato sealed a famous win for the Mulu men. Bay of Plenty were also mightily impressive with a 50-point drubbing of Otago and Tauranga. The Bay scoring 8-1 in a lopsided encounter over the current Ranfurly Shield holders.
He had no right to score that. Putsitai shows his strength and a Superman finish.
With the drive going, Hawke's Bay, they march into the end goal and they get their second try.
And the other Bay, Hawke's Bay, played the conditions well in Palmerston North, scoring a number of rolling maul tries to overpower neighbours Manawatu.
JK, were you feeling left out or something?
I mean, you've got plenty to say.
He's just come on over.
Yeah,
father and son talking about coaching their kids. I've got volleyball, soccer, rowing.
And rowing.
So, yeah, I still pretend I can coach them.
Well, you spend plenty of time with Eroni on.
Yeah, I think the nice thing just talking and seeing Caleb is that Eroni changed the game a wee bit. You know, during my career, we were sort of playing it wide, but then as the defences were starting to speed up, all of a sudden Eroni comes on the field and there's this more, you know, robust, get us over the advantage line, set ruck. So
that's so nice, Sir John. Do you realise I saw that coming at me a lot?
I
was at the Warriors and I think there might have been a game in 95 that I can remember. I don't know if we've got any, have we got any footage or...
You know we've got footage.
I'm just checking.
You know we've got footage.
I just wanted to...
What?
What's... Understand...
Hold on. Oh, what's Evan?
Look at your hair. Who is that? Harp.
Oh, Ronnie. You didn't get sucked in.
Oh, we won.
Yes.
Yeah.
Colin Hawke, you know where you are. You did a fantastic job. This is what happens on this sort of show. Did he ever talk about Sir John Kirwan?
No.
Well, he didn't.
No,
never
what
came
happened?
Up in conversation. No, just in, you know, about the great man and the contribution for Auckland and Blues rugby. And
what he does tell me though is like Sir John Kirwan just walked down the street of Auckland City and try and step people. That's how he practices steps.
Yeah.
So he told
That's
me
so true.
To try and do that. To try. Obviously, yeah. Don't because I'm not cooked.
No, my uncle Dick Hagee is a really important point. So my uncle Dick Hagee, who played rugby league for New Zealand, he said to me, if you want to be a great sidestepper, if you see a bit of chewing gum on the ground, a bottle top, you always should be stepping it. I was walking down the street stepping it. Yeah,
that's
a really good point.
That's awesome.
Yeah, okay, Caleb, I'd love to ask you a question because, you know, you get sort of put into academies so young. What sort of decisions do you need to make as a young man? Because it's not easy to make it, right? Everyone thinks, you know, you've got 300 kids coming out of first 15, you know, 30 or 35 get selected. But what's sort of going through your mind as a young man? I mean, difficult decisions and hard ones to make, yeah?
Yeah, definitely a lot goes through my mind. When I was finishing high school, I was still sort of struggling with the pressures of
being a son of an All Black. So that was one thing. But that's sort of the time I opened up to my dad, so he helped me a lot. Around this Auckland decision, like, there was no better place to stay than home. I felt like a lot of how I grew up was because of Auckland, because of the Blues, and so I felt like, you know, it's time to give back and play for, you know, the city that I love and just want to do something awesome for this sort of city.
And, Eroni, for you, I mean, you're a big part of that as well. Now, you're a big part of Auckland rugby. What's your role there and, you know, why are you so dedicated to seeing this great team get back to where it was?
Yeah, of course, we're quite invested now with the new role as president of Auckland Rugby. And I think that's one of the great things is continuing that legacy, seeing these young players coming through and being able to give them channels and ways to be able to play their potential, but at the same time making sure that they've got the right supports around them. Because we're not just thinking about the here and now in terms of rugby, but we've got to think about going on from the game as well and the sort of people that they become. It's not just about them as athletes, it's got to be about them as people as well.
And I think the easy thing for us to say is you should show loyalty, but I disagree with that. The union's got to come up and make it an easy choice. And I think, you know, Caleb, not easy. You know, you have, I mean, I remember we were at an under 18 trial match and there was 18 people on the sideline from rugby league, you know, from the other franchises. It's just the way it is. But, you know, it's hard for young men to say, well, you know, education choices, it's not easy to attract them, you know, at times.
Before we go, just quickly, difficult result on the weekend against the North Harbour, but in saying that, you mean, you're defending champions, everyone's coming after you. This week doesn't get too much easier. A Thursday, you're up north.
Yeah, definitely. So we know, you know, the Taniwha's a proud sort of city, so we've just got to go up there, play with our hearts. We really want to try and, you know, what we talk about in our sort of circles is, you know, bring that pride back. We weren't happy with how we played, so someone has to pay, and it's Taniwha now, so...
I'm pretty sure I've heard your dad say that before. We're not happy with how we play, and someone has to pay. That's a great way to finish. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.
Thanks, Eroni. You'll be with us back over there. Don't go away. There's still more to come.
Stick around. Up next, the experts have their eyes on the North.
Yeah, welcome back to The Breakdown. Plenty of us to talk about, of course. It has been a massive, massive weekend of rugby. It's time for us to keep an eye on what's happening in the Northern Hemisphere. Steph, what's been going on?
Yeah, so England have obviously just announced their 31-man squad. Now, let's have a look at the squad here. There are some notable omissions from the squad, which is Dylan Hartley and Danny Cipriani. Now, Ben Teo has also been left out. We're assuming it's due to a recent training camp incident with Mike Brown. Eddie Jones is obviously not putting up with any ill discipline in his World Cup squad. Now, speaking of England, someone that is involved in the World Cup squad for England is Manu Tuilagi. Here's a clip that we found from over the weekend.
Yeah. Just watch this. Explodes through, and then all of a sudden, bam! Accelerates the swing. He's gone in the gap. Look at the support. How good is this, lads?
I can't get all those Welshmen. Look at them chasing the silly kids. They shouldn't be chasing that big fella.
That's great.
I'll be running the other way.
And he's had a hard few years. But when he plays, the last time he played against us in the All Blacks, I think it might have been 3 years ago, and man, he's a hard man to stop.
And when you think about the performance, you think about that team and the performance of a guy like a Billy Vunipola, how important is that going to be? We look at that England squad, a very important result from them against Wales to start their World Cup campaign.
Yeah, well, if we watch, you know, he gives the impetus for that team to go forward. They lost them second round in the World Cup last World Cup, and they lost their sort of go for it. This guy is so good, it's not even funny. I've tried to tackle him a few times, and it's scary when he's running at you. And you know what? He's a real character. He doesn't mind saying his mind, what's on his mind, which is makes rugby exciting, doesn't it?
We think, though, in the context of this game, the big news coming out of it was the loss of Gareth Anscombe. It looks as though, well, it's confirmed that he has a knee injury, an ACL, I think, JK, that rules him out. How does that hurt Wales? And it's very unfortunate for the young man.
Well, I think if you just look at the past of World Cups, New Zealand went through three, didn't they? You know, you need a great backup in this position. It's really sad for him. Young man had adversity here, went away and had a great career. So that's really sad for him. Just on a side note, don't write Wales off. You know, they are a very, very good side. And they're playing again this week too, aren't they? Yeah,
but this was an English side that had mainly second-tier players. George Ford, the first 5'8". Do you see him here getting some advantage over the likes of an Owen Farrell?
Oh, I don't think so. But I was really impressed with how Ford went. You know, the way he controlled the game. He's really matured in terms of that aspect. You know, that Farrell just brings a different aspect. What will be good is where he sort of sits now that Tio's out as well. Do they push Farrell out one? You know, and then you've got a, you know, it's sort of similar to what the All Blacks have got. Except you've got them in, you know, in terms of a playmaker role, but you've got them 10 and 12.
He's quite keen on Jonathan Joseph at centre. So to me, I think he's definitely the backup, George, to Owen Farrell. And, you know, England are blessed with some options out that back line.
I don't think you take Tio and Tuilagi. So you got Tuilagi, push Farrell out with 20 to go, push him to 12 if you need to. That's why Tao missed out.
And we shouldn't forget as well, Japan. Now, they got a good win over the USA. They were the winners of this year's Pacific Nations Cup. Let's go back to Steph with tonight's notice board.
Yes, on the notice board tonight, of course, we've got another doubleheader this weekend. The Black Ferns playing the Wallaroos, followed by another All Blacks Wallabies game. We also have the Sir John Kirwan dinner tomorrow night on Sky Sport 1 at 8:30. We happen to have JK here. Do you want to give it a little plug?
Who's that?
It was invite.
How do I plug this? Yeah,
you don't plug it, I plug it. Everyone, you know, get along because they're going to bash him. It's going to be good fun. They're going to peel shreds off him. Yeah. It's going to be a great afternoon.
Evening.
And all proceeds go to the
Maris
John
Club.
Kirwan.
Maris Club.
Oh, the Maris Club.
Maris Club.
So it's a worthwhile cause. Is that right, Jake?
That's correct. Good, well done.
Nice.
You will go to heaven.
Nice work. You're still not coming. Have you still got anything else, Steph?
Yeah, we've also got on Thursday night kicking off the weekend of rugby, Northland playing Auckland in the Mitre 10 Cup. So a big weekend of rugby ahead.
All right, well, massive thanks, first and foremost, to Ronnie Clarke and Caleb coming in to the studio live with us. As you said, JK, I can't wait for this weekend. It is all on. It's all happening at Eden Park. Thanks, Mills. Thanks, Ellie. We will see you next week. Just scared.